Hi folks, how you doing? Kel here. Well, I have a series in La Gloria Cubana cigar, which is a domestic cigar. I see domestic, not made in the States. I think it may be made in the States, actually. Anyway, it's not a Cuban, though. See the end? That's actually a little piece of tobacco there in the shape of an end that they glued to the cigar. I've had a few of them fall off. And I find myself in the mood for a nice Maduro cigar, so I'm going to light this sucker up. It's pretty still out here today. What I want to talk about today is my experience going from working for Checker Auto Parts. This flame is so small that it doesn't want to. This lighter, for some reason, the flame no longer really wants to go big. I don't know what's wrong with it. I purged it and put new fluid in and stuff. But we'll just light this baby up here. Toast the edge. Anyway, when I was going to college, I worked for Checker Auto Parts, which was fun in a lot of ways, but I think it was basically a scumbag country company, at least my experience when they were kind of a bunch of scumbags. You know, they also owned Yellowfront, which was attached to Checker Auto, and where I lived, there was a big building, and most of it was Yellowfront stores, most of it was Yellowfront. And the end of the building had Checker Auto Parts. These were run at separate stores. They were run as actual separate stores. And separate employees, separate managers, everything like all that stuff, separate assistant managers. And frankly, the yellow front there was run by a woman, this big, huge, fat woman who was extremely lazy. And the store, just a different atmosphere altogether. And the proof of that is that when the Yellowfront went out of business, they had to close it down. She sat there on a glass case with two of her favorite friends who she'd hired to work at the store and watched everybody else, including me, which I was called over to work in that store to help them close it down. She sat there on her ass on this counter while everybody else worked their ass off dismantling the store and all the gondolas and all that stuff, you know, and getting rid of all the stock and stuff when it was closed for 2 or 3 days. Sat there on her butt. And at the end of that, the second day, she got off her ass. This one was, don't tell someone who's morbidly obese here, by the way. This morbidly obese woman. Probably weighed 300 pounds. She stands up along with the two buddies she'd hired to work at the store. She stands up and there's these red lines across the back of her thighs. And one of her friends or buddies who she'd hired to work at the store, who didn't do much work, in fact, I could tell, says to her, "Hey, what are those red lines across the back of your legs?" They were wearing shorts because, you know, the store was closed. "What are those red lines on the back of your legs?" "I don't know." You know, trying to look. She's trying to look around. She can't look around. She's so fat. "Hey, you've got them too." And they've been sitting on these counters so long, they made these permanent red lines across the backs of their thighs. And none of these idiots had any clue where they'd come from. "Oh, you've got them too. What's going on here?" Now, I'm angry about it because, not because we were doing all the work and mind the work. It wouldn't be weird to be working the Checker Auto Parts anyway. It's kind of fun in a way. But this was during Christmas time, I believe it was. And I could be wrong about that, but we had a good group of hardworking people. How about that for light, ladies and gentlemen? The Kel method of light cigars. It's a good method. I think it's the best method ever, personally. We're all, you know, sitting there one night and they call a meeting for our store. When they call all the employees from our store, except for me, because I had to run the store, the auto parts store, They call them all over in the yellow front, because it was one big building, but they're separated by a wall, and there was a door between the two buildings. And it was actually a break room in the other building. Anyway, we had good employees in the store. We had a good group that worked hard and knew auto parts and all the rest. One girl named Kim, who was quite attractive, just a nice person. Beautiful gal, but she wasn't egotistical or anything. She was actually quite nice. She sat there at the counter sometimes, did this couple of times. I guess I knew she was flirting with me. I was seeing her know any better, and I had a girlfriend anyway. But one, this happened a couple times in the morning, maybe at night too. It was just her and I up there. I was, doing the auto parts and getting the parts, and then she was running the till. And I'm standing in front of her talking to her, and she just gets this funny grin on her face and goes, "Oh, it's cold in here. Look how cold it is. It's really cold." I had no idea what she was talking about. And then she basically points at her nipples, and she had huge nipples on, and just poking right out of her shirt. I'm like, "Oh my God." We actually, long story, but I had a girlfriend, but I thought about dating her, but didn't, one of those things. I did date her once, but I had a girlfriend, and my girlfriend knew I was going to do this, and she wasn't happy about it, but we didn't. I could have actually had her, but I didn't. She actually invited me. I took her out and we had a drink and took her back to her place, and we saw a movie together, and she invited me into her apartment, and I just said no. My wife's been too nice a guy, frankly, but anyway. Good employees at the store. Good people. And so they invite all the employees back in the yellow front of the break room to have a store meeting. And 5 minutes, half an hour later or more, 20 minutes later, whatever, these people come. There was actually Kim, who was a checker. There was another woman who was a checker, too, who was a pretty nice person. And two or three other employees who I'd been working with for 2 or 3 years. They come walking out of the back room from the other store and through our back room, crying tears. They fired them all. And they gave their jobs to these asshole, lazy pieces of shit from Yellowfront. And they were lazy. They were not good people, not good employees. And I don't know if they did it because they had been there longer, I don't know what the deal was, but see, I always figured, separate stores, where they run a separate corporation. Well, maybe one corporation, but separate stores. It just pissed me off. They did this at Christmas, for Christ's sake. I still work there, of course. We had a hick manager at checking out a part, and I was quite a hick, just a real jerk. He was gone at some point. Then we had a guy came in there who was actually a roving store fixer who'd go around store to store, in the chain and fix stores up. And he was a good guy. He was Bob. He was really a good guy. He was strict, but you knew where you stood with him. His attitude was, you can get your work done, you can sit around and bullshit the rest of the night, I don't care. As long as customers didn't care, if you don't do busy work, but just get your work done. So I'd always do that. I'd get my work done as early as I could, the batteries and stack the batteries and all that stuff. Clean everything, and then you could sit around for half an hour and bullshit with your fellow store employee. He didn't care, as long as things were done properly and customers were handled. And that corporation screwed him over too, by the way, as I understand. Anyway, but I was not happy working there. I just hated working there, as a matter of fact, because the manager before him was just a stupid, ignorant hick, who, by the way, hated me, and one of the reasons why I found it, because I had an assistant manager there. Not the guy I taught, Howard, not the guy I talked about, who was a good guy and a friend. A work friend. Anyway, there was another assistant manager working there who went to school all the time. He was a full-time student. And I worked from 12 to 9, or sometimes from 5 till 9. And a lot of times from 5 till 9 I'd work. The manager hated me. I could tell he didn't like me. He looked at me like I was a disease or something. And then at one point, the other manager, Howard, who was a good guy, he told me, he said that this other guy, this other assistant manager, what the assistant manager would do is, on nights I worked with this guy, he would go over and sit in the break room and study all night long. He wouldn't do any work at all. I did it all. I mopped the floors, cleaned everything up, cleaned the store, put the batteries up and all the cores, and worked with the customers. I pretty much ran it alone. 5 to 9 especially, everybody else is gone except for him and I, and that's how it was. And I didn't say anything. I should have probably said something. I'm not a rat after all, a tattletale. He'd go over there and he'd study. He'd smoke cigarettes in the break room over there in Yellowfront and study, for school. You wouldn't do liquor work. Well, what happened was, what's happening is, he would come to work the next day at noon when the manager, the general manager of the store was there. The general manager would ask, him how things go last night, you know, blah, blah. And he would say, he would take credit for everything I'd done. Oh, I did the batteries, I cleaned the store, I mopped the floors. Well, what did Kelly do? He didn't do anything, he just stood around, didn't do anything, he didn't want to do any work. And this went on for a year or more. And finally, a new manager, this Howard fellow came, a new assistant manager came on. And we saw this hick manager who was an idiot. And Howard clued me that was going on. And eventually the manager, regular manager guy, was fired because he's an incompetent. And this store fixer came in. They brought this guy in. They would go from store to store to store, fixing stores up and getting him to run right. And he was a really sharp guy. He could tell right away that this guy named Dave I'm talking about was just a big brown-nosed, lying scumbag. He brown-nosed everybody and act like he's anybody's friend, but he's just a scumbag. And this store manager, new store manager came in, who was his job in the company was to go to a store, work there for a year, clean up and fix up and get it running right, then leave and go to a new store. He was there like a special fixer guy. And he did a really good job. Cool thing about him was, he saw right away who the brown noses were, who the liars were, and he fixed their little boat for him. He fixed their little wagon for him. And in Dave's case, I made a bet. I've always been fond of making bets. And I made a bet with Dave he would not be able to quit smoking cigarettes. He said he was going to quit smoking cigarettes. I said, I bet you won't be able to. And bet him like $100, I think. If you ever want to make easy money, bet a smoker they can't quit smoking cigarettes. It's kind of cruel because they're all gung-ho at first, you know. They think they're going to make it, but they never do. It's easy money. I mean, I made several of those bets in my lifetime. It works out pretty nicely. Anyway, so I bet Dave $100 he would not be able to quit smoking cigarettes. And maybe, I think it was for 6 months or a year, he wouldn't smoke cigarettes for 6 months or a year. He has to have a time limit on your end or it couldn't be a bet. So Howard comes to me one day again and says, Kelly, you know Dave's smoking cigarettes. I say, yeah, I know. He actually would go back over in the other store into the break room and smoke a cigarette there and not think I could smell it on him when he come back. I knew he was smoking. But I wanted to get him really deep. I wanted this idiot to be smoking cigarettes in the back room of our store when I wasn't there so other employees would see him so there was no doubt. So I just let it go on, you know, the smoking bet. And of course he's lying and saying he isn't doing it, of course, to me, my face, of course, saying he's not smoking cigarettes because he was a liar. And so this new manager, this new fixer guy, he knew what was going on. He was very hard on Dave because he knew Dave was a liar and a scumbag and he wouldn't put up with any of his shit. You know, he let Dave go on and on, but he knew just who he was. Again, this Bob guy, this fixer, he told the employees, you know, just do your work, get your job done, and handle the customers. And then if all the stores clean up, the batteries are put away, the cores are done, all that kind of stuff in an auto parts store, everything's neat and tidy. As long as you keep working with the customers, you can spend the rest of your time job owning or whatever at night, which people do anyway. And that was nice. It was nice to know you. If I did my job and worked at it and did it right, then I would be looked upon decently. So that's how it was. Shit, if things were done, he'd sit around job owning with you a little bit, you know, and you know, whatever. Anyway, so this new store manager and his wife had the assistant manager over to his house at one point. And Howard comes back and says, Kel. And he did not like Dave at all. He thought Dave was a real scumbag. He said, you know, Kel, he said, you know, Dave was smoking cigarettes last night at Bob's house, right in front of Bob's wife and me and everybody, you know. Maybe some other employees were there. I don't know. I know I wasn't there. But so the next day, or that day, when Bob came, Dave was there, the lying smoker was there, and Bob was right there. We were all standing at the back counter at the you know, parts counter, and Howard was right there too. I said, Dave, out of the blue, I just say, Dave, I would like that $100 you owe me. And Dave's so stupid. Look at the light of that cigar. Really, try the Kel method when you like cigars. You'll be a lot happier. I said, I'd like that $100 you owe me, Dave. You know? Dave goes, $100. I said, $100 you lost in the smoking bet. You've been smoking cigarettes, Dave. And Dave goes, no, I haven't. I've been smoking cigarettes. I haven't smoked a single cigarette. You know, I'd smelled it on him. I'd gotten in the break room when he was back there, and he had, you know, cigarettes he put out and all dumb bullshit. And I said, Dave, you were smoking cigarettes last night at Bob's house, right in front of Howard, too. No, I haven't been. I haven't smoked. I was not. That's not true. Is it, Bob? He turns to Bob, this manager, who's a smart guy, and who didn't really like Dave anyway, really. And Bob just turns to him and says, no, Dave, you're lying. You were smoking cigarettes last night at my house. Dave's face just drops. And I said, I'll take that $100 now. And I made him pay me $100. And he didn't want to, but he had to then. He was trapped because Bob knew about it, you know, and Howard and everybody, he had to pay me $100. That was a sweet $100, my friends. So sweet. Anyway, as I mentioned in the videos, my dad had Parkinson's disease. It's a horrible disease. I wouldn't wish that, and I wish that. Well, there's one enemy, I wish that. Some scumbag who tried snaking my girlfriend. Anyway. So I ended up quitting that job. I was leaving school, just left school, and decided to go in business with my father. And we actually opened up the store and got up and running in my spare time. And then I quit the parts store and went to work with my father totally. We were co-owners and did that. And I hated that working at that place so much. This will tell you how much I hate working for other people. I mean, I've worked for myself my entire life, mainly after that. I've had one other job in my life. It was a regular job. And this will tell you how much I hated working for other people, how much I despise. I'd rather be poor and broke than work for other people. That's how much I hate working for others. I actually would have nightmares if I'd wake up in a cold sweat, almost in tears, dreaming I was back at Checker Auto Parts. I would actually... This happened when I was in business with my father and making good money, and it was wonderful. I'm going to talk about that in a minute. Maybe I'll make a separate video. I would actually wake up in tears. Not actually crying, but just, I would have this horrible nightmare where I was back at Checker Auto Parts shuffling, you know, starters and alternators, you know, and generators and looking at parts and working under that piece of crap manager who was a hick, that dumbass. This is the level of that guy's jokes. Not Bob, but the guy before him. This was the level of his humor. Almost every time that asshole would walk out of the back room with a starter in his hand, like a box with a starter for a customer, he'd go, bend over. He thought that was really funny, and he said it 1,000 times. He'd be walking back to the back room to get a part. He'd be coming out with a starter in his hand. This guy would wear a bolo tie. I'm sorry if you guys wear bolo ties, but come on. He'd wear a bolo tie. You know, he's just a real hick. Hit guy. He wasn't from Montana. And that was his big hilarious, bend over. And he'd laugh, think it was really funny. And the guy was just a complete and total ass. So maybe if the other assistant manager, Dave, had not been lying about, you know, the work I was doing, maybe it would be different. I talked about that in another video. But I actually had nightmares for years when I was in business. Because being in business was so fun and so enjoyable. I would have this nightmare that I was back. It traumatized me so much working for this place. It was so awful. And the management, the owners, created a very awful situation for everybody. Treated their employees like crap, in my opinion. I would actually have nightmares that I was back there again. I can still tell the rest of it here. When I got in business, to make a separate video, when I got in business and transitioned to being with my father in business, my view of the world completely and totally changed. I used to describe it as, when I was working for somebody else, it was like working in the basement of a large, tall building, of a skyscraper. And when I was working for somebody else, I was in the basement. I couldn't see anything. I didn't understand how the world worked very much. You know, it was just, it was stuffy, it was claustrophobic. It was, like I said, I had nightmares. How bad, how much I hated it. You know, and when I started working for myself with my father, I mean, for one thing, it's hard for me to get to work on time. I would usually get to work like a minute or two before I was supposed to be there. And this always enraged most bosses I've ever had. They think I should be there half an hour earlier or something. I'm not going to do that. I'm not paying me for it. I'm not doing it. So, with my father, though, he was a big early riser. He would always get to the store fairly early, actually. And I would get there, you know, around the time we open up. just before. Sometimes they get there an hour or so early, and the first jar we had a big, huge wood stove in the back of it. It was a modern building, but it had been a car shop or a shop for working on big trucks at one time. It was a big, giant building with a big, high roof, and there was actually a wood stove in the back of it, a big, giant barrel wood stove, which we used to heat the store in the wintertime at that time. And I would actually go in there an hour or two early sometimes to stock that stove when it was cold in the wintertime, and I would crank it up and sometimes smoke a cigar. Put my feet up on it, you know, and my feet get nice and warm. It was a wonderful time. Sitting in a chair, you know, an antique chair, rocking chair, whatever, and smoke the cigar, some cigar anyway. And but other times, in summertime, I could get there even later. Though usually my dad and I would get up at 6 in the morning and go to the garage sale, so before, you know, the store opened anyway. So, but anyway, the point is, it was more flexible, you know. In the afternoons in that store, a friend would stop by sometimes, you know, and he and I would go downtown, buy cigars, and come back. You know, my father generally wouldn't smoke cigars. Sometimes he would, I guess, but not very often. He did when he was younger. And we'd sit there and smoke cigars out in front of the store, and it was slow and late in the afternoon sometimes, you know. And, you know, my dad liked the occasional beer. I think we had a refrigerator there, I think. Or maybe we had a friend of the store who would stop by named, got one of his name off, and that's really sad. But he became a friend of ours, and he would stop by, you know. He'd bring my dad a beer, and he would sit there and drink a beer, you know, in the last hour when no one was coming anyway, and tell stories and talk about stuff, you know. And I met people. Look at the burn that thing, by the way. Look at the light on that sucker. Come on, that's a thing of beauty, isn't it? Anyway, but just being in business like that, you know, having your own business where there's no boss breathing down your neck all the time. You do what you want to do when you want to do it. You know, you work harder. I mean, the hours I spent there working at night from, you know, 6 o'clock till midnight, you know, fixing things and doing things. You know, I did a lot of that, you know, especially when you're first opening the store or we were changing things. I remember one time I decided to panel the entire store with pegboard. You know, I put on the walls and I painted when I was on the walls. And that was a tremendous amount of work. My father couldn't do that. You know, I spent, you know, many, many nights doing that because it was a huge store. I think it was huge. I don't know how many square feet it was, but it was huge. It was probably a third of a block or half a block long. Something like that. It was very big, and you know, big store. Anyway, but it was just the air, the being able to breathe, you know, and meeting people. There was a guy I met there one time who was a, I think he was actually a janitor, a custodian at high school, but a local high school. But he was heavily involved in trying to get a mail order business going, you know. And he had all these weird schemes and plans all the time. He was a very interesting guy, you know. He would advertise in the back of magazines and sell little ideas and things and sayings and cards, and all sorts of weird stuff he was doing, which I thought was fascinating. You know, it's later on when I had my own little business, when Dad and I weren't in business anymore, but I had my own store. That's when I met a young man who was trading commodities. He'd made $50,000 in 3 months trading soybeans. And that got me interested in doing that. Because you learn so much more when you have your own business. And you have so much more freedom. You know, I'm not saying everyone should be in business. It's very hard also. And there were a lot of lean times, tough times. And we went through a recession, which kind of killed our business for various reasons. Other problems and this and that. But still, the freedom of it, to be able to make your own money and exist without having to worry about some asshole boss or and to couch out of stupid, ignorant rules that don't really mean anything and really aren't important to you. It's just a beautiful thing, you know. It's not saying it's for everybody. Me and my father, you know, we didn't go borrow money to start the business. My father had saved money his whole life when he was, you know, working for the people. And he had some cash. I think he had like $15,000 is all, you know. And I had this 55 or 54 Austin Healey 104 I'd restored. And I'd put that in the business for my part. In fact, actually, the store was big enough. It had a garage door on it. A couple big, huge garage doors. Two were sealed off, but the other one we used to load stuff in with. And I actually had my car in the store. I had this 55 Austin Healey, it was a red, beautiful thing, in the store for sale at the time for quite a few years before we left that location. I did sell it in the store. But, you know, so that was kind of cool. It was big enough to actually have a car in the store. Later on, I had a Corvette, a 72 or 3 Corvette convertible with a 454 engine, and that sat in my other store. We had a second store, which was big too, and had a big garage door in the back of it in the back room. But I actually bring that in the store. I also had a Jaguar XKE, a 67 Jaguar XKE that I restored one time. And again, I just brought that right in the store. We had this big, huge back room. It was, you know, and then we had a big front room in this other store, and, you know. But the freedom to be able to do that kind of thing, have to be able to, you know, if you need to take off and do something, you go. You know, I didn't get any vacations really because, you know, I had to be there at all times, you know. I couldn't take off for 2 weeks at a time really easily because my father, you know, couldn't run on his own too easily, but that's a trade-off. But I didn't want to, you know. You know, the only problem with that kind of thing, running a business, was that, you know, I got so into it, you know, so it just becomes part of your life, you know, I mean, it's just everything in a sense that, you know, I found myself when I was like 26, I hadn't belonged to a martial arts club for several years, and I realized that I'd been so focused on this business, first going to school and on that, that I kind of let myself go like I have now, and, you know, I wasn't having as much fun in life as I could have been having, and that's when I decided to get back to the martial arts when I was like 24, 25, 26, somewhere in that area there. And I did search out a good karate club in town. That's when I got in that club and stayed in that club and taught in that club for almost 20 years, 17 years, something like that. But the vision, you know, the what you see and what you know about the world changes so much. For one thing, it's one reason why I despise government the way I do. Tonight, on the TV before I came out here, I saw that Conan O'Brien had that Elizabeth Warren socialist scumbag communist on the show. He gave her a whole show to talk about her redistribute the wealth, communist bullshit, for Christ's sake. It's just unreal to me he would do that. But then again, Conan's really a big Marxist. He's a socialist. He doesn't say he's a Marxist, but he is a Marxist. He believes in all that stuff, just the same way David Letterman did. He's always going after corporations, David Letterman was, and companies and business and all that stuff. You know, and he's using his show as a platform for you know, attacking business and business people, and of course Republicans, because they represent business supposedly. I don't know if they really do, but being in business like I was with my father, we had contact with government, and every contact we had was a negative one, trying to screw us out of our business and stop us and screw us around. I'll give you an example of this. When we first had this first store of ours, this big giant store, it was a big blue building, which had been a shop for working on, I think logging trucks or something, so it was a big shop building. But we cleaned it out and painted the floor and cleaned the whole thing out really good and painted the inside walls and made it into a store, big giant warehouse type store. And at first, it wasn't doing too good. It wasn't the greatest location in the world. In fact, it was behind the new post office, the big post office here in town. But we just weren't doing so well, you know. And one day I got the idea in my head after a couple months, you know, people just don't know what kind of business this is. We'd had a sign made which was about 20 feet long, about that wide, that said our name. It was called the Second Time Around Secondhand Store. You know, and had collectibles and antiques, but the letters were only about this big, you know, it was not a very good sign, really. It couldn't be really seen, clearly, I don't think, from the street. It was mounted low in the building. So, I got a wild bug at my button, and the light went on one day, and I actually went outside. I went and bought some paint, and I painted a big white square on the end of the building, and by our front door. It's probably 8 feet tall, or maybe 10 feet tall and 10 feet wide, and I just put a big giant letter 2, ND store, secondhand store, and it was really, because we carried really nice brand new used furniture. It wasn't a junk shop like you see. It wasn't anything like that. It was like a really nice, clean. You know, we carried nice used books, and in one section, and it was a college town where I lived, so people would. We're always looking for nice, clean, brand new looking furniture. We'd buy a lot of that at the garage sales and things, you know, and then the antique section. And I put this sign on the wall. I painted it one day. And I'm not kidding you, as I was up on the ladder painting it, people started vroom, stopping on the chair, vroom, started pulling up. And overnight, our business went from being one that was, to being successful. I mean, literally overnight, that's how much difference that sign made, I mean, it was amazing. As I'm painting this damn thing, I'm sitting there looking down, my dad's inside the store, and cars begin pulling up that were going to the post office and traveling around the back of the post office and stuff. It just began pulling up, one after the other, people going in, looking at our store and buying things. All of a sudden, our shelves began to clear off. You know, we were actually selling lots of stuff, which gave us more money to buy things, you know, interstate sales and garage sales and, You know, you'll see those containers, those shows on TV where they go and they buy, you know, they buy storage units. We did some of that, a little bit of that too. And it completely transformed our business overnight. I can't tell you how important it is to have a good sign in your business. It's more important than what's inside the store. It's more important than the store itself. It's more important than anything. It's just insanely important. So I put another one on the other end of the store too, which faced a really busy street. And from then on, we did really good business, me and my father. We were doing really well. Unfortunately, that location, it was very, very hard at that time to find a location to rent in my town. I mean, I'm not kidding. There was nothing around. When my dad and I rented that location, and my dad knew about it because one of his relatives actually had been renting it. When we rented that location, as we were cleaning it up, you know what I'm saying, the doors were open, we were cleaning it, we had to take a hose and spray off the entire ceiling because it had dust and stuff in there, and just clean it totally and paint the floors and paint the walls and everything and make it suitable for an antique store. As we were doing that, 10 times a day, someone would pull up the thing, hey, is this going to be for rent? We want to rent this right now. Because all these people couldn't find buildings either. It was that hard to find. And we were only paying, believe it or not, we were only paying $500 a month for this thing. But the reason why is because a bank owned it and bought the property. And they were going to tear it down in 2 or 3 years and build a new bank there, which they finally eventually did. And that's when we had to move our location, which is a whole other story. But the point is, that's how important having good signage on your business is. It's not a small thing. Well, not long after we were in business, oh, my cigar's on fire. Not long after, I'm going to have to tip this ash off because I found out, my cigar's on fire. That's when my ash will fall. I would like to wrap it with it, which is, I just have to. I'm going to tip the ash off here. We had to move. The bank said, yeah, we're going to tear this down now and you got to get out of here. Which we knew was coming. It was, you know, blame the bank and all. We, you know, that's where you got such a good deal on the rent. We've been there 3 or 4 years, made some good money, but we couldn't find a location for the dam. And also what had happened in that period of time, the local government here had become more and more powerful. A lot of Californians come up here and go to college here, and then they want to live where I live, which is a nice area, but then they want to get government jobs and screw everything all up. A bunch of neo-Marxist scumbag pieces of crap, frankly. And our city created what they call the planning board, a bureaucracy, which you had to pass their specs or you couldn't open a business. Literally, you had to do what they told you to do or you couldn't open your business. And one of the things they made is a sign ordinance. Our city fathers, the scumbag pieces of Marxist crap, create a sign ordinance because they don't like big signs. Saying you can only have a sign. For a business our size, the sign would have been about this big. Impossible to read from the street. And so when we moved, we took our original sign, put that on our new building, which our new building was in a very terrible location, and that's the location I didn't want to be in. My father did. That's a whole other story. But I made a little sandwich sign. It was 2 4-by-8 pieces of masonite that were leaned together and was kind of a big giant sawhorse, and I put that out because this business was kind of off the street. You couldn't even see it was there unless I had this sign. And the city began showing up. Well, actually, what happened was maybe I'll tell the whole story. I'll tell that story, I think. But the point is, they did everything they could to destroy our business from then on with their stupid sign laws. And I'll tell that whole story in a different video because that's not really what this video is about. The point is, anyway, though. Being a business for yourself, it's just such a wonderful experience if you're making any kind of money at all. And I made less money than I could have made doing other things, working for someone else, probably at a decent job of some kind. But it was just such a nice thing. I mean, you could come and go as you pleased, you know. I mean, I work 6 days a week. I work 6 days a week, generally from 6 in the morning till, you know, 6 at night. We were open from 9 o'clock in the morning till 6, but we would go to garage sales and estate sales and you know, once in a while, these you know, storage unit sales they would have. But it wasn't like work because it was all on my own behalf, you know. And I could make more money than I would, working for somebody else anyway. So it was a beautiful thing, and it forever put the hook in me to work for myself. Probably a bad thing, because I've gone through long periods of my life when I wasn't making money, when I was, you know, eating shit for a living, you know, and you know, and I worked one other job later on in life because I was out of business and, you know, thought it was time to, you know, do something different, and that's actually two of the jobs I worked, actually. But, and they both sucked. It sucked ass, totally, because they had idiot managers who were just basically a bunch of a-holes that took manager jobs because they wanted to have power over other people. That's why people hate managers so much, because most of them take the job being managers because they get off on telling other people what to do, not because they want to do a good job. I think in some ways, anyone that actually wants to be a manager should not be allowed to be. Because I swear, people get in managerial positions, especially middle management for like retail and stuff, they do it because they've got a screw loose in their head. They just really get off on pushing people around. That's my personal opinion. But anyway, it was a wonderful thing. And I wouldn't recommend it for my own son, per se, because it's been very tough on me in life to go through periods where I wasn't making money. And you know, there's I wanted to buy a Harley-Davidson motorcycle for many, many years. And every time I wanted to buy one, I had the cash to buy one, because I'm not going to buy one on time, by the way. I don't do that. I could have done it, but, you know, I had better uses for the money. You know, I can buy a Harley and have the fun of riding around on that, or I can put that money into some kind of investment and make some money. And it's always been, I've always erred on the investment side of things, you know. If I ever made it really, really, really big and I had money to burn, I might buy a Harley. I mean, I had, like I say, I had a Jaguar XKE, a 67 XKE that I bought and restored and, you know, eventually sold and made some money on that. And I, you know, Corvettes, and I had cars. I had a Porsche, one pine during that time, but a motorcycle. And I did have a motorcycle too, but not a Harley. Boy, that's a wonderful cigar, by the way. Series N, Maduro, La Gloria Cubana, Series N. It's a wonderful cigar. Anyway, the point is, it is a good thing to do if you can do it. I don't know if I'd recommend borrowing money. We never borrowed money. We always used our own money. When I went out of business, of the several businesses I have had, they're small businesses though, you know, I didn't owe anybody any money. The bills are all paid, didn't go bankrupt or anything like that, you know, and came out with cash too, so. Not a lot of cash sometimes, but still. It's kind of nice. But it's just a whole different view. I mean, it's hard to describe this to you, but the view of life, you know, the larger view, you know, I didn't really finish what I was saying. Working for other people is like working in the basement, at least it was for me, you know like the old saying, they feed me, you know, I must be a mushroom because they feed me bullshit and keep me in the dark. It's like being in the dark. It's why I hate government the way I do, though, because government just it fucks with people all the time when you're in business. I mean, one thing which always outraged me, every year we would get a letter from the government, a tax. Most people don't know about this tax because they aren't in business. We would get a tax, a letter saying, you got to inventory all of your glass cases, your till, even your calculator had to be on the inventory, and they'd make us pay money to them for owning that. It was a tax for our business equipment, quote, business equipment. Like, they have some right to tell us to pay them money because we own business equipment. And that's so much like the mafia, it's ridiculous. Got a nice business here. Got a lot of nice business equipment. Kind of be a shame if you had to lose that, wouldn't it? So, pay us a little bit of money and we'll let you keep your business. I mean, we paid for that shit. All that stuff we paid for Christ's sake. And yet, I've got to pay the government every freaking year for having a glass case to display my antiques in. I've got to pay them to have a till to ring stuff up on. I've got to pay them money because I have a calculator. Literally, a calculator, the kind you might have at your home, that runs a little tape, a little calculator from Staples. I've got to pay the government every year money, a tax on that, just to own it. If you can imagine. My shelves in my store, last store I had, I bought these shelves, had these shelves in my store, I had to pay the government a fee every year to have those shelves. They're my shelves. I paid for them. Aside from the fact the planning board did everything they could to keep us out of business and ruin business, and I will make a video about that. I will make it after this. You know, this is what business people put up with. And when you hear some dumb Democrat saying, oh, Democrats are good. I had some guy in line the other day said, Democrats are good for business. They help business, help people have jobs. No, they don't. Republicans aren't much good either, but Democrats are the worst. They are socialist, Marxist assholes who don't like business. They don't like people being in business. They think business is evil, and therefore they do everything they possibly can to screw you out of business. I'll make the next video about that. That'll be next. The point is, being in business gives you a perspective on life and the world. You meet people, other business people. You meet, you know, the regular folks. And you just have a view of life, which is very, very different than working for a wage. Nothing wrong with working for a wage. It's probably better off for most people. It probably would have been better off for me, but it opens your eyes. You see things much differently than you would, and much farther than most people would. And you see the world bigger and understand the world more. I'm just saying you do. I'm not being egotistical. It's just a fact. Because you've got the ability to do that, sit back and do that. You're not always, you know, have your nose to the grindstone, have some manager whipping you in the back. And that's probably why a lot of people go along with a lot of these arcane laws, because they hate their managers. And therefore they hate the business. They think the business is evil. Business isn't evil. It's got to be in the right side of it, for heaven's sakes, you know. I mean, all these corporations and business that maybe hate so much, they give us jobs. Give us an employment, for Christ's sake. There's not wrong with that. But that's it. Thanks for listening. I'm going to talk about the kind of things I encountered with government, why I hate government so much, in this next video. I'll talk about some of the things we experienced. Thanks for watching. Hope you're enjoying your life, your cigars, and your businesses, if you have one, and your life, because that's what it's all about. I'll talk to you later.